Even when I don't see it to work, even when I don't feel it to work, you never stop, you never stop working, you never stop, you never stop working. Can I just share this with you, and maybe it'll inspire your praiser? I feel led to share it. You know this, you never stop working, you never stop working. A few weeks ago, we were outside playing sidewalk chalk, and I asked my son to pick up the pieces and start gathering them. And he looked at me and he said, "Well, Mom, what are you gonna do?" And at first I thought, man, that's pretty sassy. But then it came to me. He had no idea that while he was gathering and doing his part, I was going to go in the house and get a Ziploc bag to keep the chalk in. He had no idea that even when he didn't see it, I'm working. He had no idea that if he would do his part, I'm not going to sit back and watch him do something, and I'm going to help and partner with him. But he didn't know. But he had to do his part. And he questioned, are you going to help? What's your part in this? And I've been chewing on this for some weeks and finally feel the liberty to share it. I don't know. Maybe it'll bless somebody. Maybe you're saying, Lord, you're asking me to walk in this place. You're asking me to be faithful to prayer. You're asking me to keep a joyful heart and an attitude of praise and gratitude. What are you going to do? What are you going to do? Even when I don't see it, he's working. Even when I don't feel it, he's working. He never stops. He never stops working. He never stops. He never stops working. Even when I don't see it, he's working. Even when I don't feel it, he's working. He never stops, he never stops working. He never stops, he never stops working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. He doesn't know how to be anything else. And you're not alone. You are not alone. Because you will go before me. You will never leave me. I am not alone. I am not alone. You will go. Deep water, the fire.
Praise the Lord. You can be seated this morning. Man, I tell you, I don't know how many times I told the last crowd how good they look, and you do too. You look good this morning to be here in the house of the Lord, so many today. You know, we had a wonderful service this morning, a very good turnout, and I'm so thankful you would be here today and that we can gather together. I was sharing with the people. You know, my wife's been faithful to sit right in the middle, and I've just been preaching to her Sunday after Sunday. There's nobody in here. She looks good. I believe that. I'm thankful for her. And you look good today. It's good to see more numbers and more people that you could come and be with us. So thankful today that you're here. Now, before we would go further in the service and get into the Word, I just want to highlight some things to you that just need to make known to you and help you with this time that we're in and the situation here now. First of all, I want to say this to you. Everyone has an opinion, right? That's okay. You know, we all got opinions, and that's good. But here's the thing. We need to be respectful of each other's opinion concerning this issue and what we're in now. Please be mindful. Maybe some others don't think like you do concerning the whole virus, the issue, church, being in the building. Some people are walking in different places than you are. And they have children, maybe health issues, whatever. So be mindful. Your opinion is okay, but we all have a responsibility, and that's why you see what we're doing here and being careful in every way. We want to be mindful of each other, so I encourage you, be mindful of others around you. They may not think like you do concerning the whole issue. Now, the other thing I just want to say to you is this. Every person makes the decision on their own, the choice to be here. Thank the Lord that we're able. We have the way that we can, the size building that we can do this, two services. It still comes down to your choice, to your decision, whether you feel now's the time to come back. But I'm saying that because if you don't feel that it's time or someone else does not feel it's time, don't be ashamed. Don't feel guilt. Don't feel condemnation because you're not here yet. And don't put that on someone else, okay? Because, again, everyone is in a different place than you. So if you don't, it's okay. Continue with us online. It's online now, 11 o'clock, and you're able to watch there until you feel ready to come out. But it's okay. The next thing I want to say is this. When it comes time to close, we are releasing by rows. There'll be those that will let you out, starting from the back to the front by rows. The door will be held open so that you can go on out and we don't conjugate and gather inside the building. That's for everyone's safety and their thoughts in it. So wait, please, after we pray until you're ushered out, and then we'll go from there. Want to say this too, we will continue. The 11 o'clock service online, is live streamed this very moment, and we will continue Wednesday night at 7 online. Still not meeting in the building Wednesday night, still getting a grip on all of this. Before this service, in between the two, we've wiped down the building, and there's different ones that the doors have wiped down, and they're there to help you. But it takes a lot to do this. So Wednesday is still online. And the 11 o'clock Sunday morning is online. Also, when you go out, you'll see the offering. There'll be no offering taken up. The buckets are at the doors, and you can drop your offering in, side door, the other two doors, as you go out. And the Lord blesses you and uses you as that conduit for blessing others. And we want to continue to give you that privilege and opportunity so you can drop it in the buckets as you go. Praise the Lord. I think I've got everything in there. Now I'm going to preach the word to you. Just thankful that you could be here. I don't know how long we'll be like this. We'll continue on. God's ministering. He's going to move in it. This did not catch him by surprise. He knows very well what's going on, and we're going to just continue like we are. But nothing stops you from worshiping the Lord. Praise God. First service, second service, at home. You still worship the Lord. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Okay, so let's get with the Word of God this morning. And I'd like for you, if you could, turn to Acts chapter 2. Acts chapter 2, and I'm going to read to you this passage of verse 1 through 4. As you're here today, you may not be aware that today, our first Sunday back, is Pentecost Sunday, right? This is Pentecost Sunday. You may be, and you say, well, what is Pentecost Sunday? What does that mean? Well, Pentecost Sunday, just to describe it to you or tell you what's taking place, for many churches all across America today, all around, Pentecostal Sunday is this, the day to celebrate the anniversary of God's outpouring of His Holy Spirit upon the church. The early church in the book of Acts, this is what happened. Pentecost Sunday is when He poured out His Spirit upon that early church, and that early church was never the same. They left that place without pouring the Holy Spirit, and they did a great work for God. a great work for him. Acts chapter 2, 1 through 4 describes it to us. Let's read it. Here's what happened. God poured his spirit out upon the church to get them moving, doing what he and what we are called to do in this time until he comes again. And here's what it says, verse 1. When the day of Pentecost did fully come, they were all with one accord in one place, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. Then there appeared to them divided tongues as of fire, and one sat upon each of them. They were all filled with the Holy Spirit, God pouring out His Spirit upon those 120 gathered together. They were all filled with the Holy Spirit, began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave the utterance. Poured out His Spirit, they left that place being the church. Now I want you to jump with me to Acts chapter 17 as they continue under the power of the Holy Spirit. Acts chapter 17, I want you to see what the world at that time said about this group of people, these disciples of Christ, this early church. What did the world say about them? Acts chapter 17 and tells us of Paul and Silas. Paul and Silas were very effective in the ministry of sharing the gospel. And they would go into one city, go into a place, and they just began to preach the gospel, preach the gospel. Man, they didn't back down. They were bold. They were very free with their words. They were open, and they had no fear whatsoever to share Jesus with everyone that they went to. They explained how he had to come to this earth, suffer and die, carrying your sins and my sins, and he was going to die on a cross. They told others that then he was going to be raised from the dead, back to life, resurrected. And then they were just proving to people that he was the Messiah, that he was the Christ. Now, many of them, the Bible says, believed. Many of them were converted, thank the Lord. Many of them came to accept that as the gospel. But there were unbelieving Jews. There were other ones there, and they were causing confusion and persecution. They didn't believe, and they wanted it stopped. So here's what they did. A great multitude were persuaded, but many were not. And I want you to see now what takes place with the unbelievers trying to stop the church. And here's what it says in Acts 17, verse 5. Acts 17, verse 5. Listen to how they described that church. But the Jews who were not persuaded, they didn't accept this, becoming envious, took some of the evil men from the marketplace and gathered a mob, set all the city in an uproar, and attacked the house of Jason and sought to bring them to the people. Bring who to the people? Paul and Silas. They were after Paul and Silas. They wanted them stopped. Okay, and the church. But look at what verse 6 says. Here's how they described them. But when they did not find them, they dragged Jason and some brethren to the rulers of the city, crying out. Now get this. These who have turned the world upside down have come here too. These people, the church, who have turned this world upside down, now they've come upon us. In other words, we got to get rid of, they're turning the world upside down. Now, I don't know what that does to you, but every time I read that, I'm telling you, excitement comes up in me. And excitement comes in me that says, man, look how they handled these people. Look what they thought of the church that day. They said, man, these people are turning the world upside down. It excited me, but at the same time, it challenged me. I started writing questions down. Concerning myself. I said, you know what? I wonder what they say of us. How do they look at you and I as the church today? I put this down, this question. How effective am I being in making an impact to this village, to this county, to this community? How effective is the church being in this community, in reaching the community? This church, WAG, how effective are we being in making an impact in the community? How about this? Can the church today, can this church and the church as a whole today still be accused of turning the world upside down? Can they say that of this church today and the church? Can we be accused of taking our world and turning it upside down? Well, my answer to that is this. I believe we can. I believe we can, but it won't be me and you. It won't be you and I on our own efforts. No, it's going to take the power of the Holy Spirit to do it. That's what Pentecost was all about. Pentecost was the birth of the church, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. He came upon just ordinary people, just like you and I, and then they left that place never the same and turned the world upside down. Now, I was reading an article a few weeks ago. Our general superintendent, Doug Clay, of the assemblies, he wrote this statement, and it just caught me. I'm thinking Pentecost. I'm thinking about the effects of Pentecost. And you remember, as I read to you, it said on the day of Pentecost, as the Holy Spirit fell, he said, they all spoke with other tongues as the Spirit gave the utterance. Some of you today, I would ask, and I'd say, well, what Pentecost mean to you? And probably you would say, well, speaking in tongues. Well, that's part of it. It was evidence that they were filled. But notice what the general superintendent said. Here's what he said about that. Being people of the Spirit, that's what we're talking about. Are we people of the Spirit? He said, being people of the Spirit is of little value if all we do is speak in tongues. It's of little value if all we do is speak in tongues. Now, I'm not belittling that, and he weren't either, speaking in tongues. You folks know me well enough to know I believe, and I'm thankful for being able to speak in tongues, pray in tongues, pray in my prayer language, the benefits of speaking in tongues. I'm all about that and so thankful. That is part of it. But I see what he's saying. It's of little value if that's all Pentecost means to you. Here's what he went on to say. People of the Spirit are a people on mission. Are we on mission today? He said, people of the Spirit are on mission. Since the book of Acts, that mission is clear. To do what? Tell the whole world about Jesus Christ. Tell them Jesus is alive. And they did that, and it turned the world upside down. People of the Spirit went out on mission telling everyone that they knew about Jesus, and that's what changed their world. He said in Acts 1 and 8, you shall receive power after the Holy Spirit comes upon you to do what? Be my witness. Be my witness, praise God, to tell others to go turn your world upside down for Christ. So, here's my thought this morning on Pentecost Sunday. And the day we've come back together. How do you and I turn our world upside down? Now, my thoughts first went like this. That depends how you look at that, what side you're on or where you sit spiritually. You see, before I was saved, come to know the Lord, I was out here in the world. And when I was out here in the world, I looked at the church and all that they were doing as they're the ones upside down. Really, I thought, man, going to church every week, using your whole Sunday, praise, you know, to go out there. Man, what are these people upside down? But giving tithes, giving you money, you know, pay it, your hard-earned money, and you give. It's upside down. How about this? Forgiving those who have hurt you. That's what church, forgiving those who have offended you. That's upside down. I mean, I couldn't wrap myself around it. I'm out here, and I thought the church was upside down. See, when you're in the world, church stuff looks upside down. But now that I'm over here and I'm in the church, I look out there and I realize, no, I'm not upside down. I'm right side up. There's a world out there that's upside down. And in case you don't know it, you are living today in an upside down world. I think we can agree on that. Look what's going on all around us. This world is upside down. But you see, to those unbelievers, they looked at it and said, man, these church folks have come in here and they're turning the world upside down. No, they weren't. It was God. Praise God, empowered the people, filled them with His Spirit so that they could go in an upside down world and right side up it. Hallelujah. That's what we're called to do. I don't know if that's a word. I told the early church that. But right side up it. That's what we are doing. We're not upside down. We are right side up in a world with kingdom principles, love and peace and joy and power of the Holy Spirit. Yes, walking in that love. So we are called to right side up an upside down world. Amen? And how are we going to do that? It's going to be through the power and person of the Holy Spirit. Those 120, Georgia, that were filled with the Holy Spirit, it changed their life. They walked out of that place, they were never the same. But here's the thing. Every place they went to, when they left it, that place was never the same either. what they do, they right side up it. How about it? Are you right side up in your family? Are you right side up in your workplace? Are you right side up in this community that's upside down? That's what Pentecost is all about, and the power of the Holy Spirit to help you and I do it. So this morning, I want to just encourage you, challenge you, Spirit-filled people, a Spirit-filled church. How do we go about right side up in this upside down world that we are in, being the church, through the power of the Holy Spirit? Number one, here's what I said, see that they did. Going through the book of Acts. You may want to write these scriptures down, these places, and take them home with you. But here's the thing. First of all, that I see that they did. These people in the book of Acts, living a Spirit-filled lifestyle, they had a spirit of praise. A spirit of praise that came over them. A spirit of praise. I want to ask you, how's your praise today? A spirit of praise. I'm not talking about a time of praise. Thank the Lord for it this morning. I'm not talking about just a time of praise in our worship service. I'm not talking about just singing a few songs. No, these people had a spirit of praise came over them after they left that upper room and went out in the community. You see, in Acts chapter 2 and verse 11, the Bible tells us that all the crowd that had gathered together testified. And verse 11, look what it says. It says, we heard them speaking in tongues, but then it says, what were they speaking? The wondrous works of God. They were speaking everywhere they went, the wondrous works of God. Praise to God everywhere they went. It goes on to say in verse 47 of Acts 2, they were continually praising God. Everywhere they went, they were speaking life. They were speaking life in death situations. They were speaking life when people were hurting. They were speaking life. They were praising, speaking the wonderful works of God because they had a spirit of praise about them after being filled with the Holy Spirit. I'm saying that because I really think that sometimes we forget how powerful sincere praise can be in attracting other people. You can walk into a place where it is nothing but lifelessness and doom and despair, and you walk in there as a Spirit-filled believer and turn that situation around and somebody's life around simply because you're not going along with speaking negative. You're speaking life. You're going to speak the wondrous works of the Lord. That's praise. Not just singing a song. Speaking the wondrous works of the Lord. What He's done for you. How good He is to you. How He's empowered you. How He's helped you. You can turn the tables on somebody's situation by speaking this of life. Everywhere you look, cut on your device, turn on the news. It's nothing but negative, negative, negative. I've had so many people tell me over this time that we're in, I don't even watch the news no more. I banned myself from the news. Why? Because it was just attaching itself to them. That negative stuff growing on them. And you got to be careful with that. So that early church left that place with a spirit of praise. I want to ask you, you have a spirit of praise about you? That every place you go, you're speaking the wonderful works of the Lord? Speaking that works of God. Charles Spurgeon, he's an old-time minister, gone, powerful minister. Listen to what he said. He said, brothers and sisters, the very best work we can ever do on earth is to adore. The best work we can do is to adore. He said, you are blessed in prayer. He said, but you are seven times blessed in praise. Praise God. Seven times blessed in praise. And you realize as God blesses you in your praise, speaking life, you bless others in speaking life. Seven times blessed. Let me help you with this. Here's what happens. He loves our praise. He loves you and I speaking praise. I was reading the story just recently. A lady had gone to her door that morning. She went to the door of the house and she was going out to pick up her newspaper that had been delivered. So she opens the door to her house, looks down there, and there right in front of her kneeling is this little dog. Stray dog. She didn't know him. Weren't her dog. Never seen him before. There's a little dog sitting at her door. And that dog sitting at her door, she looked down. He's got her newspaper in his mouth. He's delivered her the newspaper. That lady, you can believe, man, she was so thankful for that. She just began to praise the dog, patting him on the head. You good dog. Thank you. Took the newspaper from him. She was just pouring the praise on that little dog for what he did. Even went in, got him a little chew, little dog bite, gave him that, gave him another. Said, thank you, little puppy. Give me my newspaper. And off the dog went, and she went in, enjoyed her paper. The next morning, she walks out to the door. She's going to get her newspaper, opens the door, and you know what? There's that little dog. Dog sitting there again, and in his mouth was that newspaper. But guess what? You know what else? Surrounded around that dog was 8 more newspapers. 8 newspapers that the dog had bought back. She spent a whole next hour having to take the neighbors their newspaper that dog had bought to her. What am I talking about? I'm talking about, well, look what a little praise did for that dog. He went and he delivered more. You see, it's amazing what praising can do. That's what we sing, right? Hallelujah. Look, it's amazing. I don't know how heavy you are right now, but how about just praising God? Why don't you just lift your hands? It's amazing what praising does. And just say, Lord, I thank you. I thank you I'm alive. I thank you I'm here today. I thank you for blessing. I thank you, Lord, for being with me. I thank you for helping me. Just praising God. A spirit of praise came over those people. And they did it everywhere they went. He inhabits the praises of his people. He rides on the praises of his people. Spirit-filled people, Pentecostal people, live in a spirit of praise. Hallelujah. Number two, are you with me? Praise the Lord. Number two, that's how they right-sided up an upside-down world. Now, number two, what else do you do? I see this with that church. They had a passion to tell others about Jesus. A passion. They had to tell other people about Jesus as a result of Pentecost. You remember Peter? Peter was the one who denied before Jesus was crucified. Peter was a follower of Jesus. And now things are going south for Jesus. He's going to go to the cross. And they see Peter. And they say, look, that young maiden went up there. She said, look, you were with him. You know Jesus. You knew you were one of his. What did Peter do? Not me. I don't even know the man. Don't even know the man. I haven't nothing to do with him. You see, he cowered right down. He was backed in a corner, and when he did, he crumbled under it. He crumbled under that. But Pentecost comes, the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, and touches this man, fills him with the Holy Spirit. And now what have you got? Same Peter, but you got a different man. You got a man now who was a coward, who couldn't tell anybody about Jesus and turned away from him. Now you've got a man that's filled with the Holy Spirit. And look what it says about him in Acts 2 and 14. This same Peter now, look what it says. And the Bible says, Peter stood up, raised his voice. He said, men of Judea and all who dwell in Jerusalem, let this be known to you. He said, heed my words. One translation said it like this. Peter stood up and said, pay attention to me. I'm going to tell you something you need to know. You see, he was right in the midst of a large crowd, filled with the Holy Spirit. The same man that backed down now stands up right in the middle of them. And he said, wake up. You need to listen to me now. I'm not backing down. I've got somebody living inside of me who's alive. And he told the people. And you know what the result was? He gave an altar call and 3,000 souls were saved just like that. 3,000 souls. Praise God. Because he had a passion now. That's what the Holy Spirit will do for you to tell others about Jesus. You may be in here this morning and you say, well, Brother Kenny, you know, I'm not going to ever speak before 3,000 people. I'm not, and I could never do it. You might not. But you will speak to one. You will have one. Tomorrow you'll have one that needs to hear about Christ. And here we find of Philip. Philip was in a revival. And the Holy Spirit spoke to him. People of the Spirit, listen. The Holy Spirit spoke to him, said, leave this revival you're in and go to the desert road. Get on that road. And he says, and you're going to find someone. And he did. He found an Ethiopian secretary of treasury, a man of influence, in a chariot. And he walked up in that chariot And there was that one man, and look what the Bible says he did. Philip opened his mouth, and beginning in the Scriptures, he preached Jesus to who? Him. He preached Jesus to him. Just one person. One person. And that high influential person left that chariot. He was saved, born again, baptized, and went back to his home, and revival took out there. Praise God. So you may not speak to 3,000, but you will speak to one. And the passion. I want to ask you, do you have that passion today? Do you have the same passion that you had in the beginning to tell others about Christ? Passion makes the difference. But how do you get the passion? Outpouring of the Holy Spirit. I was talking to or reading another story. This gentleman that owned a jewelry store and many diamonds, many different types of jewels. And there was a man that was looking for a certain diamond. Certain one, he said, and it's a collector's, I got to have that certain one. Well, the owner of this business, he said, you know what? I think I got the one he wants. I've got the one, I know I've got that diamond. So he invites him. He says, he arranges a meeting. He says, you come to the place, I'm going to show you this. I think I got the one you're trying to collect. Worth a lot of money. So here's what he does. He arranges the visit. This person's coming. And here the owner says, he takes his number one top salesman. He said, now look, he's coming. I'm turning him over to you. You show him that diamond and you do your best to sell it to him. I said, okay. So here they arrange the meeting. The man comes in. The owner is standing over here and he's watching. And he put his best salesman on him and he showed him the diamond. He showed it to the guy. He's looking at it and he's describing it to him. He's going into all the knowledge about how that diamond was formed, how hard it is, what the shine on it, all the makeup about this diamond. Man looked at him. He said, you know, I don't think that's it. That ain't the one I want. Sorry. And he starts to leave. Well, the owner's over here and said, wait a minute here now. He was certain that was the one he wanted. Owner went over and said, wait a minute, sir, wait a minute. Can I talk with you? And he took the diamond. He gets with the gentleman and he starts to talk to him, placing the diamond in his hand. And just a matter of seconds, that man, same diamond, said, that is it. That's the diamond I wanted. He said, now I'm going to buy that thing from you. And he started out with it. Sold. Deal done. They start out the door and the man that bought it said to him, asked the owner, said, will you tell me something? How come you sent me that salesman and the salesman could not sell me that diamond, but in a matter of seconds, you sold me the diamond? Same one. He said, I'll tell you why. He said, he is my top salesman. I pay him a lot of money. He said, but I'd pay him more money if he had one thing that I've got that he doesn't. And he said, what is that? He said, he's got knowledge about that diamond. He's got head knowledge all about it, can tell you everything, how it was even formed. He said, but what I got is a love for that diamond. And what I described to you was out of love, what that thing's doing and what it means to me. The passion, the love. See, sometimes we're like that. We may have a knowledge of the gospel, knowledge of the truth, but what's going to set it apart to where you're going to have a passion to tell others about it is, do you have a love for Jesus? When you have a love for this Jesus who set you free, who filled you with His Spirit, that passion will come up in you and you have to tell others about it. And that man took that rock and he told him out of love, look at this thing. Look how beauty. Look at the eloquence of it. Look how wonderful it is. Look how precious it is. And praise God, it was sold. That's what happens. Listen, if you've lost your passion, praise God, fall in love with Jesus again. Fall in love with Him and let the Holy Spirit pour out His Spirit upon you and ignite that passion in you to tell everyone you meet, your family, your home, your neighbors. That's how you turn an upside down community right side up. When's the last time you had a passion to tell somebody about this Jesus who's done so much for you? Praise God. Let's just thank Him once again for saving us, setting us free, and all He's done for you. And I pray passion. A passion to tell others about Christ over this church. Okay, number three. Number three. We're turning it right side up. Are you with me? Number three. How did they turn that world that was upside down, it's, listen, they lack no fear. No fear, no fear whatsoever. See, the Spirit-filled church had no fear when it came to sharing with others and telling them about Jesus. Nothing, no one, not even the enemy, Satan himself, could stop them from telling about Jesus. Whenever they were confronted with wickedness, they continued on, rebuked the enemy, and they didn't shrink back. They shared the gospel. They had confidence in the Holy Spirit's power to work through them against any tactics or schemes of the enemy to stop the gospel. In Acts 13 and verse 6, you'll remember, there was this Roman official, and he invited Paul to preach to him. Paul, I want you to come and tell me about this Jesus. And there was a sorcerer there, that's what the Bible says, trying to hinder and interrupt Paul's preaching. And I want you to see what Paul did. Paul's not going to stop and back down just because someone's going to interrupt what's going on. Look what he does in Acts 13, verse 9. Acts 13 and verse 9. Then Saul, also called Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit. There's the difference. Filled with the Holy Spirit, looked intently at him. He's looking at this one that's trying to hinder him of preaching the gospel to this Roman official. He looked at him and listened to his words, verse 10. He said, "O fool of all deceit and fraud, you son of the devil, you enemy of all unrighteousness, will you not cease perverting the straight ways of the Lord?" You see, he's rebuking. He's rebuking that one. And verse 11, "And now indeed the hand of the Lord is upon you, and you shall be blind, not seeing the sun for a time." And immediately a dark mist fell on him. He went around seeking someone to lead him by the hand. Then the proconsul believed when he saw what had been done, and being astonished at the teaching of the Lord. You see, he didn't back down. No fear, rebuked the enemy. And look, what was the result from that? Turned that man's world right side up. It says that he became a believer. The Roman official was saved. Another time, Paul and Silas, they're preaching the gospel. And this girl, slave girl, comes along and she had a spirit of divination. And she's mocking them to try to stop the gospel from going forward. And verse 18 of Acts 16 says this, Paul, what did he do? No fear. He turned to the spirit that was working in that girl. And he said, turn to that spirit. He said, "I command you in the name of Jesus Christ, come out of her." He came out of her that very hour. What was the result? Took that girl's life, took her family's life, turned it right side up. They were upside down. But it says here, it led the jailer and his whole household to being saved. How? They had great confidence in the Holy Spirit's power and fear, no fear whatsoever. This is not natural courage. You and I don't have it in ourselves. But when you're empowered with the Holy Spirit, He'll give you a courage and a boldness you don't have on your own to not back down, not shrink back, and share the gospel wherever you are. Fourthly, what turned that world upside down? People of the Spirit. Fourthly, they expected the supernatural. Everywhere they went, they expected the supernatural to occur. Miracles. Miracles. Do you still expect miracles when you pray? Do you still expect the supernatural to take place? If not, Holy Spirit baptism will change that in your life. Being refilled again. You can't go by experience what happens and what don't happen. You have to go by the Word. And the God that worked miracles then still works miracles today. And that early church continued to believe in the power of the Holy Spirit at work. In Acts 9, it tells of Peter and the saints of Lydia. He found a certain man named Aeneas. That man had been paralyzed for 8 years. He'd never walked. 8 years. And look at Peter. Peter that was expecting the supernatural to take place. Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit. Look what he says. He says, "Aeneas, Jesus the Christ heals you. Arise and make your bed and walk." That's all he said to him. You're the confidence. He's expecting him. He said, "Jesus the Christ heals you. Get up and walk." And immediately he got up and walked. Healed, touched by the power of God. The supernatural took place in his life. At Joppa, certain disciple named Tabitha, she became sick. and died, it tells us. And they sent for Peter to come to them. And Peter went in the room and he made everyone leave that room. But he knelt down and he prayed, expecting the supernatural to take place in her life. And verse 40 says, and turning to her, the body, he said, Tabitha, arise. And she opened her eyes, and when she saw Peter, she sat up. What were the results of that? And it became known throughout all Joppa, and many believed in the Lord. You see, signs and wonders will follow those that continue to expect and believe in the supernatural. And that's how you turn the world right side up. Continue to pray, is what I'm saying. Continue to believe. Expect God to move. Expect Him to follow with signs and wonders when you pray. He's still working miracles today. Do you believe that? He is still a miracle working God. And when you pray for someone, believe and expect that supernatural. We must expect it and continue to believe. That's the result of Pentecost. And fifthly, how do the people of the Spirit turn the world right side up? I want to say this, they continually felt the urgency to share with others about this infilling of the Holy Spirit. I'm going to share that with you on a personal line. When I came into Pentecost, into this church, out of a denominational church, I didn't know anything about even what I'm talking to you today. I didn't know anything about the baptism of the Holy Spirit. I came into this not knowing anything. But I am so thankful, as I shared with the early church, I am so thankful that there were people in this church that continually, man, as I told them, here I was, come from Manio, married this home girl, one of theirs, and man, they were, I don't know about this now. Whole situation had them shaking. And then saw, I got saved, give my heart to the Lord. But then people didn't stop there. They said, Kenneth, you need to get filled with the Holy Spirit. You need to get baptized in the Holy Spirit. You need to infill another Holy Spirit. At the time, I didn't really appreciate all of it, but I'm thankful today they didn't stop. In one ear, get filled with the Holy Spirit. There was an urgency. To see, and I would not be sharing the gospel today, I'm convinced, if I had not received the baptism in the Holy Spirit. I know I would not. No, but I'm telling you to say, as a church, we've got a people that are coming up, know nothing about what I'm speaking of, know nothing about the importance of Pentecost and to be filled with the Holy Spirit. I want to tell you, there's an urgency. Don't stop sharing with others the need for being filled with the Holy Spirit. It's not in any way you're a second-class Christian. If you've never received the infilling of the Holy Spirit, you're not a second-class Christian. No, but the infilling of the Holy Spirit is to enable you and help you to be that living church that He's calling to do what we cannot do on our own. We can't accomplish all this on our own. But praise God, that church, empowered by the Holy Spirit, can. Amen? And then lastly, here's what I see of how you're going to turn that world upside down as a Spirit-filled church. And that is this. They prayed. They prayed, and they prayed, and they prayed. It started in an upper room, 120. That's where it all began. They were in one accord, and they were praying. But they never stopped. He never stops working, but it's a people that never stop praying. Why is that so important? So that He can continually immerse you with His Spirit so that you can live out what we're saying. You see, Acts 2, they continued, it says, steadfastly in prayer. Acts 3, they were going from temple to temple praying. Acts 4, when they were persecuted and threatened, what did they do? They gathered together and they prayed. And they said, God, give us more boldness that we can go out and God would infill them again with boldness. When they needed direction, they prayed. When they needed wisdom, they prayed. When they needed more power, they prayed. They continually prayed and sought God. They never became so busy that they ceased from praying. And it's prayer that kept that church and that ministry alive. It kept it fresh. It kept it full. And it kept the ministry alive. Life in the Spirit. Church, no reason for a church to become stagnant. No reason for us to stop being productive in reaching others. If it is, it's because we've stopped praying and stopped asking for this infilling of the Holy Spirit. So I'm back to my question. Can we as a church still be effective in turning the world that's upside down, right side up, praise God, for the kingdom? Can we be effective in doing it? My answer is yes. If we follow this pattern that I've shared with you today, it's a spirit-empowered church filled with the Holy Spirit after the day of Pentecost, praise God, and He's still filling His people today so that we can be that people He has called us to be. We can still be that church. I'm going to ask, if you will, stand with me now. Stand with me this morning, and we're going to come to a close. I'm going to pray over you. We're not having altar time, but praise God, doesn't stop you from receiving this word, having it embedded in your spirit today. I'm so thankful you came. So thankful you were here today. I want to encourage you to continue to come, be a part with us, and take your place in the family of God. We've got a great work to do. But I'm closing with this passage of Scripture, or this quote that I read. Again, it's from our general superintendent, Doug Clay. Here's what he said, and I like this. It's a good place to close. He said in this quote, "Everywhere the people of the Spirit go." That's the church. We want to be people of the Spirit, not people of the flesh, not people of carnality, people of the Spirit. He said, "Wherever the people of the Spirit go, they live in such a way that the power of Christ is visible." Think of that. Wherever the people of the Spirit go, they're living in such a way that the power of Christ is visible. That's how you turn the world. You make a change. Is Christ visible wherever you go? The power of the Holy Spirit? That's what He's saying. And I want to encourage you. If you're running low, get filled again. Just ask Him, "Lord, fill me once again so that I can be this supernatural church that you're calling to be." A spirit of praise. If you lost your praise, let Him fill you again. A passion to tell others about Jesus. Have you lost your passion? Fall in love with Him again. A lack of fear. If you're having a lack, He'll give you boldness. He'll give you courage. Maybe you're doubting, even in the supernatural and the miracles. Let Him touch you again, that you will expect the supernatural to take place. And then tell others of the necessity of being filled with the Holy Spirit. And here's my story. I need a Savior. Lord Jesus, You're it. And I'm asking You in my heart and life, I want to make You my Lord and my Savior. Forgive me of my sins. Cleanse me. And I receive You as my Lord and Savior. And the Bible says He'll do it. He'll forgive you, cleanse you, and come to live within your heart. And for the Christian today, for those that have, maybe all of you have, I want to encourage you. Pentecost is alive today because He's alive. He wants to fill you again and again and again, that we can be this church that will turn our community right side up, praise God, that is upside down, turn it that way for Christ, praise God. So receive this prayer today. Let me pray for you. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank You for this people. I thank You for every family. God, I ask, Lord, if there's one that would not know You as their Savior, I pray, Lord, they take this word today, call upon You, ask You in their heart and life, receive You as their Lord and Savior. Praise God, and begin a new life in You. Father, I pray for this church, God, that You would empower us, that You would empower us once again. Immerse us with Your Holy Spirit, just like You did on the day of Pentecost, that we can be effective in reaching this community for the cause of Christ. Father, I pray a fresh wave, a fresh anointing of Your Holy Spirit upon every person today. God, that we would be the people You have called us to be. We thank You and we praise You in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. As you're there standing in your seat, please don't go nowhere yet. The ushers are going to come and allow you to exit row by row. They're going to start from the back to the front. This is for safety and protection. They'll hold the doors for you. If you want to give of your offering, the buckets are in the back. You can drop the offering up on the side table. But please. just letting him come and lead you out. Ushers, would you do that? God bless you. Let's go win the world for Jesus. Come back next week, 9 or 11, and praise God. Let's worship him. Love you, Jesus.